BBC News.
Starting over on BBC Radio 3 now, Sarah Walker presents music by Brahms, Debussy and Sibelius in Essential Classics. In three quarters of an hour here on Radio 4, the industrial sprawl of Nairobi is the location when we continue our Book of the Week at 9.45. First, here's Midweek with Libby Purves.
Hello. Today, the man who moves the good old ukulele a long way on from George Formby, not before time, and sings like a nightingale, Simon Clothier. We have Max Zachs, an aspiring reform Jewish rabbi, moving on our awareness of transgender people. Arlene Phillips, who wants us all to dance exuberantly to big musical numbers and provides the choreography. And Antonio Carluccio, who wants us all to eat more beetroot and provides the recipes. Arlene, you could make him dance, couldn't you? You could make anyone dance.
I think I can make anyone dance, because I think people feel that they can't dance, but actually think about Saturday Night Fever and John Travolta. Everyone thinks he can dance, and all he did was walk forward 2-3, clap back 2-3, side, and he was dancing.
I'm not sure you're going to convince Simon Clothier. You dance, he claims to have two left feet.
You make that sound so easy, Arlene. Well, I can't dance, actually. I'm the odd one out in my family because my wife is from the Caribbean, and the whole family's got fantastic rhythm, apart from me, so I'm very much the odd man out. So.
But as your musical ukulele playing career carries on, you're going to have to learn to pop your hips a bit, aren't you? Because one of the things Arlene's done, you've had to teach lots of pop singers to look as if they can dance, haven't you?
Oh, many, many, many.
You've got Elton moving.
Elton. I got Elton moving his hips.
We're going to start with Simon Clothier, who has an album out, Songs from a Small Guitar, because his instrument is the ukulele, and his other instrument is a very sweet, melodious voice and talent for songwriting. It's just, as you've got a rather fabulous, highly varnished uke on your lap.
Do you like this one?
Yeah, give us a strum. Give us
a quick strum.
Yeah, a quick strum.
Start the show. Okay. Take one special kind of kiss. And one stolen night of bliss. I'm here, you see, with Arlene. Midweek, I mean, memories are made of this. Antonio's here too. Memories are made of this. A Max who plays the uke. Memories are made of this.
Yay! I can see Josephine Baker in Banana.
We had absolutely no idea he was going to do that. He really wasn't. And in fact, he didn't. He only knew a few seconds ago that Max plays the uke as well.
I do. I don't know if I played that well, but or that convincingly.
What, Simon, what made you pick up this particular instrument rather than a guitar or something blokey and serious like that?
Well, it was my dad, when I was a child, had a couple of old ukulele banjos, George Formby endorsed ukulele banjos, and got them out one day, and I was smitten with it, because they're quite immediately gratifying for children. I think that's what's really good about them. I did morph onto the guitar and things like that in later life and wanted to become a rock singer, but it's like an old friend, and it's very therapeutic to just sit with the old ukulele and have a strum after a stressful day.
There's something sort of unchallenging about it, isn't there? I mean, not that it's not there isn't skill in playing it, but it's a humble kind of instrument. It doesn't put on any airs.
No, absolutely. And you say there's skill in playing it, Libby. It's very gracious of you. In actual fact, they're very, very easy to play and to get to grips with. And the challenge is you can play a song within an hour, as you were telling me just before the show. And,
well, they did a show in Edinburgh, yes, where they claimed they could teach anyone to play that you can in an hour. It's got a bit sort of overconnected with George Formby and all that cheeky chappy stuff, hasn't it? But in fact, there are sort of world masters. It's sort of moved on since then, hasn't it?
Yes, I mean, any self-respecting ukulele player can knock out George Formby when I'm cleaning windows, absolutely. But it has moved on in recent years, and I suppose the interesting contrast, speaking to Max before the programme, is the way the instrument is viewed in the Pacifics, in Japan and Hawaii, where it's taken very, very seriously. And, you know, there's a Grammy category for Hawaiian music, and I can assure you the guys that play it very differently to the way I do.
We're going to come to your Hawaiian adventure, but we want to sort of fill in how that happened, because you are by trade a builder. You rent out equipment. You take great big diggers and things around the country and sort of help with the Wembley Stadium and Olympic
right.
stuff and stuff like that.
Yeah.
But were you the kind of chap who tea breaks, having just delivered a forklift, would give a quick strum on the uke to amuse the lads? What was that part of your life?
Well, they're so portable. There's another great thing about the instrument. I'd always carry one in the boot because the job would involve travel, and sometimes pull it out. You know, once or twice in the site office, certainly at Wembley once, I pulled it out and knocked out something quite random. I think it was summer of 69 or something. And when the builders eating their bacon rolls had stopped throwing things, actually really quite enjoyed it. So, yeah.
Your daughter got you to play in public, didn't she?
Yes.
You hadn't played to an actual audience that was an audience before.
Not really. I mean, I'd played the ukulele, given it up, you know, did the rock thing in the sort of early 90s without a great deal of success. And I'd packed it all in. And then my daughter harangued me to play ukulele at a school charity night at her school. So I did. I went along and pitched up, did a semi-spontaneous version of The Beach Boys' God Only Knows, which is a song I've always loved, and went down a storm, which astonished me. Unfortunately, my daughter couldn't go, so I said, don't worry, darling, I'll record it for you, just for posterity. Found a wonderful cello player, rang up a good friend called Curtis Schwartz and said, Curtis, can I come in and record this Beach Boys cover with my ukulele and a cello? And to cut a very long story short, we went from there and to Hawaii.
Oh, well, you say you went to Hawaii. I mean, I know that there's a very distinguished player called Roy Sakuma, who's
yes.
been a hero of yours, and he heard your tracks and decided that you should go to Hawaii.
Indeed. Well, I did this this Beach Boys demo and also an original song when I was in the studio and sent it speculatively to Roy Sakuma. I just Googled him. I didn't really know who he was. And I was amazed about 3 months later to get a phone call in the middle of the night, because they're sort of 11 hours behind or in front, I forget which, and answered the phone thinking it was a friend doing a prank call. And he invited me to go to Honolulu to play at the world's largest ukulele festival. So I said, oh, I'd love to come. And in the morning, of course, I woke up and realised, my goodness, I'm going to have to fly, because I'm terrified of flying.
It's a long way.
Yes, it is. And so I wrestled with this for weeks beforehand. Am I going to go? Am I not? And of course I did, and had the most surreal and wonderful experience ever.
I notice you've got the uke still on your lap now. You're enjoying just holding on to it. Did you hold it on the flight? Did it help?
Well, I didn't help this one on the flight, actually. This one was built by a wonderful person called Joe Souza in Hawaii for me. This began as a lump of koa wood at the Kanilea factory. But I did cuddle my previous favourite uke on the way out, actually.
You did actually have it on your lap?
I did, with a couple of pints of lager as well, I have to confess. Libby on the flight.
Should have got it and played it to the other person. On the flight. You say the world's biggest ukulele festival. I mean,
yeah.
How big is that?
Well, there's between sort of 7,000 and 10,000 people go to it. There was about 8 the day I played. I was so lucky because I did a radio show the day before, having been received by the mayor of Honolulu the day before that, which was totally mad, because I was the first Londoner or European ever to turn up and play. But on the day of the festival, it was quite surreal, because I was expecting some sort of little village fete thing, and it was a Hyde Park kind of thing, and thousands of people, the Pacific Ocean about 100 yards to my right, went up on stage, and I was so lucky with the scheduling, because I went on directly before Jack Johnson, and so played to a really fantastic size audience, and came off stage and didn't quite know what had happened. You know, I'm from Wimbledon.
What was your clothing?
Did you wear a Hawaiian shirt? Yeah.
Well, we all had Ukulele Festival T-shirts, actually, that we were asked to perform in. But yes, I did have a lovely Hawaiian shirt with ukuleles on, which I've still got and treasured to this day.
Flowers?
Yes, indeed. I had the garlands on and the whole bit and beads, and it's just so bright and calming out there. I really found
it
very
calming. I'd like to see you wearing that around Wembley.
Yes, with the hard hat on, actually, Max. It went. It looked
the
quite a picture.
Hard hat Wembley. let's hear a track from your CD. Songs from a small guitar. You've written nearly all of them, haven't you? They're nearly all your own.
I've written or co-written all of the songs on the album, Libby. Yes.
Let's just hear a little moment.
Just a whisper away in the cool of the shade. Will you call me? Save me. All the caution we had, did the wind throw it back?
the tracks, Simon, from the album. There's a very poignant tone in a lot of what you do, isn't there? Do you use emotions from your own life when you're writing a song? Is that sort of release thing for you?
Very much so. I'm an incurable romantic, firstly. Hugely sentimental, and yes, I mean, a lot of the things I feel come out in the music, and you know, I went through a 20-year search to find my biological father, actually, having been adopted. And when I found him, it all came out in a song. And I find that I write within sort of 10 minutes. I never can sit down and think, well, I must write a song tonight. Something will happen. I might be on the bus or in the car, and it'll be there. You know, then as soon as I get home, I'll write it down and pretty much put it out in 10 minutes or so. So there's no great science behind my songwriting other than just sentiment, really, and impulse.
Do you think your connection with practical and manual work, rather than sort of having lived among musicians and artists full time, do you think that's helped? Do you think that feeds something into your songs, which helps them connect to people?
Yes, I think so. I think it does, because you don't expect someone with my haircut to play the ukulele and sing like I do on a building site. So yes, I think it has helped the connection, most definitely.
Mobile phone is just joining in the music.
Yes.
It's not my one.
Well, keep that uke by you, because we may just possibly need to dance at the end if Arlene manages to inspire us.
Get up and move.
Ooh, yes, I feel my shoulders loosening already. I'm going to turn now to Antonio Carluccio, the great Italian chef and restaurateur who for years gave his name and his energy and his expertise to the chain we all love. Now he is, though, just an outside consultant to it. He is a man who has championed real tasty, lovable food for decades, drawing on his youth in South and North Italy.
But a little bit boring, actually.
You think potatoes are boring?
No. If you eat all the same.
Oh, of course.
So, Simon,
variety is the spice.
How are you on cooking potatoes?
Well, like Antonio, I'm self-taught. I can crack my own eggs and fry my own bacon and fry my own potatoes, but I'm awful at cooking, actually. And I'm fascinated by all the cooking programs, but I'm just hopeless, absolutely hopeless.
Some of them, they are salivating, you know, people are salivating in front of television.
You've ruined a lot of upholstery.
We do a lot of salivating watching it.
I'm hopeless.
Anyway, let's turn to Arlene, who was talking about difficult passages in life and also about being a natural inspirer and teacher. Arlene is a world-renowned choreographer on stage and video. She's got everyone from Elton to Freddie Mercury to Diana Ross moving. She got the skates rolling for Starlight Express. And in the 70s, we'll talk about this, founded the scandalous troupe Hot Gossip, which made Pan's People look as if they were doing a minuet. Then there was, of course, the great ageism row about her removal from Strictly Come Dancing by some lunatic. And now there is a book and a DVD called Dance to the Musicals, The Fun Way to Fitness. You were sometimes in leather. I seem to remember them in leather.
Yes, and the truth was, in leather...
Very well.
The truth was that one of the boys who was in Hot Gossip actually worked in a sex shop to earn money. This whole thing of make do amend, but let me say, make do amend became headline news, discussed in Parliament, and complete outrage at the thought of a dance group performing like Hot Gossip did on early evening television.
Simon Clothier never looked back.
I need to get some leather, actually.
You know what? It lives in a lot of men's memories. Yeah, but exciting times. I went all over the world from one country to the next, working with lots of big stars.
Right, well, we're going to end in a moment, but pick up that uke again, Simon, because you are actually going to take us out of this programme. I'm going to say goodbye, and then we will allow our masters up in some tower somewhere to fade you out gradually. I will say thanks to Arlene Phillips, Max Zachs, Antonio Carluccio and Simon Clothier. Back next week when among us, another musician, choir master Gareth Malone. Goodbye. Take it away, Simon.
I may not always love you, but long as there are stars above you, you never need to doubt it. I'll make you so sure about it. God only knows what I'd be without you. All together, ba 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 ba.
This might be a good time to be a master. Midweek was presented by Libby Purves. The producer was Lucinda Montefiore.